thoughts I have at night, so different from the thoughts I have by day. The moment Mama switches off the light, a thousand different questions come my way and stay. Chance in July.
Actually, it was January.
Oh, who on earth am I? Did I ever live before as a mountain lion or as a fly? My friends only think of fun. They're all such incurable tots.
Bernstein land, it's time for you to disembark.
Modern man, what is it? Just a collection of complexes and neurotic impulses that occasionally break through.
You mean you sometimes blow your top like me?
I do.
It's late, you'll know it when you see it.
time I heard the music of Leonard Bernstein was here when I was a little student in the University of Kansas, and my teacher, Miriam Green, walked me up the hill to see a traveling company, the First National Company of Candide. So the first time I knew about Candide was Hoek Auditorium. Isn't that interesting? In 58, unbelievable. They had just had it on Broadway. They were taking it on a national tour. Fabulous cast. Martin Green was Pangloss. Mary Costa, a real diva, was the Cunegonda. The tenor, the Candide, was Robert Rounsville, wonderful Canadian tenor. And, well, the role of the old lady was played by Ira Patina. Don't forget that name. It's going to come back. Oh, Mark, I'm sorry. I'm sorry I didn't tell Mark this, but, you know, he's always ready for something new. When I did this show in New York in December, it happened to be Beethoven's birthday. So I said, of course, immediately that I would sing up shortly of the Leonora aria, which would have been a first for me. And of course, yes, well, the pianist knew it, but I canceled that. But today, guess what composer's birthday it is? This happens to be, you may want to write it down on notes, the 602nd birthday anniversary of Antonio Squarcialupi. You go to Google. And I'm just wondering, I know you didn't know about this, but do you know some of the Squarcialupi Codex, that is to say, 14th and 15th century songs? I'm really sorry. I was going to continue with Squarcialupi the rest of the evening, but it would appear that it's a no go for that. By the way, in New York, I announced that it was my first farewell concert, and I said that was of 20. And a friend of mine in New York, a critic and playwright, said, no, go for 25. Well, I guess this is my second farewell concert. We don't know where that will end. Well, we don't know, do we? Friends, you've been waiting so long. walk right in. There's so much room inside here. Come right on in.
A minute on the very hottest fire when
before. Then you carefully apply the flame, as they do in the best, most expensive cafes. After the flame is out, just add the sauce to half a pound of butter with flour and mix them together. And serve.
Yeah. Well, I left KU, I went to New York, I sang in, I've told this before, but maybe some of you haven't been here. I was in concert choruses in New York at the time when Lenny was the conductor of the New York Philharmonic. He had two assistants I remember very well, Seiji Ozawa, Maurice Perez. That was very exciting to see him out there. Okay, I was singing under the baton of Lenny, but you see what I mean. I was in the chorus. Still, that was very exciting. I went to Eastman, then I went to Western Opera Theater. That was my first little summer gig. No, it was a two-year gig, really, with San Francisco Opera. And then Tanglewood. And when I hit Tanglewood in 1969 and 70, two summers, it was maybe 70 and 71, I can't remember, Lenny, there was a triumvirate at Tanglewood. Lenny, Seiji Ozawa, Gunther Schuller. Not bad. And this little kid was running around after Lenny, MTT, Michael Tilson Thomas. I didn't sing Bernstein then, I sang Kurt Vile, Kleine Mahogany, and I sang Aventure and Nouvelle Aventure of Ligeti. Wild stuff. Gunther was conducting. Lenny and Seiji would come to the performances, and I sang specially one day once Lenny asked to hear me. And so that was exciting to meet Lenny all that summer in the cafeteria and so forth, and have him in the audiences. And in 1970, that was when he was writing Mass. This is, I guess that's all.
Louder, louder.
But I kept saying, okay, Leonard Bernstein, okay, Comden and Green, okay, Leonard Bernstein, Comden and Green, Leonard Bernstein, Leonard Bernstein, Leonard. So much! He wrote so many lyrics. He wrote a simple song with Stephen Schwartz. I hear Paul Laird is here, so I know there will be a test. Who Am I? That's Bernstein. The song's from Peter Pan. The medley, Spring Is Here, that was from a play, Skin of Our Teeth. He wrote the words. Comden and Green, Betty Comden and Adolph Green. Now that was a team. They wrote, Wonderful Town, On the Town, I Can Cook Too, that's Comden and Green. I sang so many concerts with Kurt Ullman, and once we were asked to do a whole Bernstein concert at the Metropolitan Museum in New York, in their theater. Hello, Joyce. theater. And so we were singing all those songs of theirs. And Comden and Green were sitting stage left. That got our attention. Yeah. So many others too. It Will Come, Trouble in Tahiti. That's a lot of his own words too. And this next strange little song, he wrote for the 85th birthday of Carl Böhm. Carl Böhm and Leonard Bernstein, interesting that they had some kind of a relationship, those two huge conductors. Lenny, New York Jewish conductor. Carl Böhm, Vienna conductor. And he decided he wanted to write this 85th birthday song for him. But, and I thought it was about his being sort of doing some kind of Jewish dance, but I talked to Pat Wise. Remember Pat Wise? She's one of our alums. She was back to sing on The Alums Come Home. She was at the Vienna Staatsoper for years. She was a Kammersängerin, fabulous voice. But she sang a lot with Böhm. I never sang with Böhm. I saw him conduct. I saw him conduct, sort of like this. And Pat said, you know what I think that is? I think that's the way the maestro would speak to the audience. You know, sort of like, digga-digga-dum, digga-dum, ba-da-dum. So this is... Piccolo serenata.
Thank you.
Take it down a little bit. Of Lenny's. This one, of course, about that house, and it was written for to be to whatever of the four presidents that they were talking about, how they were in the White House. It could be today. The title of the song is "Take Care of This House."
Always on call.
Yes, indeed. How many concerts have we done together? One a year since 01 when I came here, plus a couple others, plus three or four others. And I'm still here. And you're still here. That's great. I'm so glad. That's a powerful song, I think. I can almost not sing it. I moved to, with my second husband. There were only two. Give me a break. There's attitude from the audience.
That's fewer than I've had.
We moved to Paris. We were there for quite a few years, six, seven, 8 years. Lenny came to Paris to show off his new piece, Songfest. I was lucky to do his Songfest in Jerusalem with the Jerusalem Symphony, and then in Tanglewood with Seiji at the helm. But I was at a lunch with Lenny at the American Embassy, and we were talking about Trouble in Tahiti. He wrote the word, it's a story of a couple that's not doing really well together. They say he wrote a lot of it on his honeymoon. So I had done the trio in some theater in France. Morning sun. Kisses of windows, kisses of doors, kisses of windows, kisses of doors of the little white house, kisses. You know that. And then that nobody helped me there. they might in the next one. Fortunately, I got to do the big role, Dinah. And Dinah goes out to a movie, and I think this is maybe the most important operatic movie critic, don't you?
Yes.
What a movie! What a terrible, awful movie! It's a crime what they put on the screen. I can hardly believe what I've seen. Do they think we're a lot of children? It would bore any four-year-old. Drivel, what nonsense, what escapist, technicolor,
is tied to a tree. Did I tell you he's a flyer who got lost at sea? Anyway, all the ladies are crazy now, running wild with lances and knives. Then they pile up the wood for the sacrifice, and the witch doctor comes and he sets them on fire. As the natives in
City Opera. I was there 25 years, and in the same interim, 14 years at the Met. At City Opera, they were doing this musical of Leonard Bernstein called Candide. Remember Candide? Yeah. Remember Hoke Auditorium? Yeah. So there I was, being the old lady there at City Opera, many, many performances and on tour. And then we did a recording. We got the Grammy for that, the best recording of the year, opera recording of the year. I went to London for the Leonard Bernstein Festival at the Barbican with the London Symphony Orchestra, singing Candide excerpts, with Lenny right up there in the audience, right there. You know, that'll get your attention again. And afterwards, I know some of you have heard this story, but I'm gonna say it again. So, in the green room afterwards, lots and lots of people there, way across the room, I heard Lenny say, "Joyce, Joyce, And he started coming across the room, and he said, "Wait, wait, I need this." Leonard Bernstein was not a very tall man. He dragged a chair over. He put it there. He stood on it to give me a kiss. And nobody had a photo. God help us. So you guys think I'm lying, but it's true. He whispered to me, "You're the best since Ira Patina." Remember Ira Patina? Yeah. Then in 88, he died at 90. In 88, he wrote arias and barcarolles, and so I got to do the first performance with him playing. Four-hand piano, and with him playing here, and Michael Tilson Thomas there. That was pretty exciting. The two songs for women, Little Smary, he wrote, well, he said it was his mother that told it to him. Jenny Bernstein is marked on the music. And Greeting, he wrote those lines to that. So first, this little strange story of what his mother, the way his mother told this little story to him. Talk, Joyce. One day, little Smary took up to take a walk with her little Wadded. See how it was. W-U-H in parenthesis, and over it says, "Everything but sound." So this one is Greeting, about his children. And when we were rehearsing, I found it interesting. It came to the time for me to rehearse Greeting. He said, "Okay, let's do the Aaron Copland song."
Thank you.
I did Arias Barkrolls a lot. Lenny died in 90, and his manager, Harry Kraut, who ran the Amberson that controlled all of the music, and my friend Kurt Ullman, the great baritone, and I were asked to continue the go around the country and sing lots of Bernstein music. We did Arias Barkrolls many, many times, and lots of the rep. But Arias and Barkrolls also at the University of Kansas Lead Center. The year before I started teaching, there's four-hand piano, as I said, so we brought a pianist. The second pianist was Jack Weinrock. Oh, yes. For the 100th anniversary of Irving Berlin, Lenny decided to do something very, very intellectually challenging, a 12-tone melody. Supposed to sing this, but Candide sings this. Anthony sang it here. Neil sang it. Oh, I forgot to say, Kelly Southworth sang a very beautiful 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. And in my studio, Breanne Stewart sings a beautiful simple gift. Of course, we did Candide here. You, many of you saw it. Wasn't it? That was great. And Candide sings this, but I love it.
the dawn will find me alone in some strange land. But men are kindly, they'll give a helping hand. So said my master, and he must know. It must be so. It must be so.
Jerry Hadley, David Eisler, gone too soon. And so, we come to West Side Story, a rather famous piece of Lenny's, do you think? So I thought, what am I going to choose? What am I going to choose to do from this? Because, well, okay, I could play so many roles in it. I could play Bernardo. I could play Riff. Well, I've done a lot of pants roles, you know, you've seen that. Orlovsky, Niklaus, two Chinese generals. I'm not kidding. I could do Maria, because lots of you have seen me in lots of ingenue roles. The witch in Hansel and Gretel. Mrs. Lovett. Augusta Tabor. Clytemnestra. Ingenues, don't you think? So then I thought, well, okay, Anita, I look Puerto Rican for sure. When I walked out, you thought Cheetah Rivera. especially the way I moved. So I thought, okay, yeah, I could do that. I could do this one, I could do that one. So I just threw up my hands and said, okay, I'll do the tonight. No, I'll do the America Ensemble.
Start a rumble, we'll rumble them right.
Anita's gonna get her kicks tonight. We'll have her private little mix tonight. He'll walk in hot and tired, so what? No matter if he's tired, as long as he's hot. Soprano. Tonight there will be no more. Tonight, Tony. Tonight, Terrifolino. But tonight, and for us, stars will stop where they are. So slowly, and still the sky is light. Oh, moon, grow bright and make this endless day, endless night. we'll tear up the town. Tonight's all right, we're waiting for you. Tonight won't be we gonna have a song.
Tonight there will be no more mixed up.
I'll see you there about 8. All right.
Tonight
we're gonna rock it.
All right.
Won't be we're gonna have a song.
All right.
We're gonna get 'em tonight.
We're gonna rock it tonight.
Tonight,
Gunetta's gonna have her day.
Nancy, Mike,
Anita's gonna have her day.
Nurse goes awesome.
Bernardo's gonna have his way.
The sky is as blue.
We're gonna whip the tune. We're gonna get 'em.
Oh, moon.
Thank God it's Eunice. Right.
Spanish too, blue like
with me, too. It's called Leonard Bernstein. Catchy. You about a new book that I've written, 100 Easy Ways to Lose a Man. Chapter 1. Now, the first way to lose a man, you met a charming fellow and you're out for a spin. The motor fails and he just wears a helpless grin. Don't bat your eyes and say, "Why, what a romantic spot we're in." Just get out, crawl into the car, say it's the gasket, and fix it in 2 seconds flat with a bobby pin. That's a good way to lose a man. He takes you to the baseball game, you sit knee to knee. He says, "The next one up, but that will bunt, you'll see." Don't say, "Oh! This game's too hard for me to pity me." Just say, "Bunt, are you nuts? With no outs, two men on base, and the left-handed batter coming up, he'll walk right into a triple play, just like it happened in the fifth game of the World Series in 1923. That's a fine way to lose a man. Knowledge in his face, he'll never try for second base. Ways to go. Now, the third way to lose a man, the lifeguard at the beach that all the girlies adore, swims bravely out to save you through the ocean's roar. Don't say, "Oh, thanks, I would have drowned in just 1 second more." Just push his head underwater and yell, "Last one in is a rotten egg," and race him back to shore. That's a swell way to lose a man. You found the perfect mate and it's been love from the start. He whispers, "You're the one to whom I give my heart." Don't say, "I love you too, my dear. Let's never, never part." Just say, "I believe you've made a grammatical error. It's not to who I give my heart, it's to whom." You see, with the preposition to, who becomes the indirect object, which I can easily show you by drawing a simple chart. That's a fine way to lose a man. Fine way to lose a man. A dandy way to lose a man. Just be more well-informed than he. You'll never hear, "Oh, promise me." Just tell him where his grammar errs, then mark your towels, hers and hers. Yes, girls, you too can lose a man if you will use Ruth Sherwood's plan. 100 easy ways to lose.